close, Fiona Hill. She is the former top White House advisor on Russia. You may also recall she testified in President Trump's first impeachment hearing, and her new book is out. It's called There Is Nothing For You Here, which is a wonderful title that we are going to explain a little later in the interview. But first things first here, you know, in this book, you call Trump's election lies a slow motion coup attempt. And you also say someone else with a little more wherewithal, essentially, could finish the job. Explain what you mean here.
Well, in terms of the slow motion aspect of the coup, it wasn't something sudden. Obviously, it wasn't a big military uprising with Trump at the head of it. But it began even before the first impeachment trial with all of these efforts to try to subvert foreign policy and sort of privatize it and deploy it in the service of Trump getting reelected. So basically trying to get the Ukrainians to open up all of these investigations of Joe Biden and Hunter Biden that they wanted to have. And then from that period on, after the first impeachment, of course, Trump starts to talk about how the election is going to be falsified. No question about it, he says, that it's going to be stolen. And then when the election comes along and he actually loses, even though he gets, of course, a phenomenal number of votes, he basically refuses to concede. He still hasn't conceded. He said he won. And we've had so many investigations and recall accounts, and we just saw this happening in Arizona, you know, everywhere across the country, questions about the legitimacy of the election, questions about President Biden and his legitimacy being raised, not just by Trump, but by all of the Republicans. And of course, in January of 6th of this year, we had an insurrection. It wasn't the armed insurrection of the military, but it was a mob that stormed the Capitol. And now we're in denial about it. So actually, what I would argue, it's not just the slow motion coup that we saw leading up to January of 2021. We're still in it. It's basically another attempt to seize back power for President Trump.
And you write vividly that the repetition of these lies and these claims, the repetition leads to normalizations. I want to read people what you write here. In doing so, he normalized his actions. It was the political equivalent of flashing that women had to put up with when I was growing up in the UK. Trump revealed himself and people just got used to it. I'm never going to be able to get that image out of my head now.
Well, I can't. You know, that happened to me so many times as a kid that, you know, this was kind of what I thought was happening when I saw it again. Somebody does something outrageous, but it happens so often. And people in other positions of authority, they don't question it. They don't say, wow, what are they doing here? And the fact that Vice President Pence, someone who could have been severely injured or even killed on January 6th by the mob basically calling for him to be hung, is now saying, oh, there's nothing to look at here. It was all fine. This is exactly an example of what I was talking about, the normalization of violence or the normalization of something abusive.
You talk about how it's not that he wanted to emulate Russia. It's that he wanted to emulate Vladimir Putin. He had some autocrat envy. With that in mind, and knowing how he works, if there were another Trump term, what do you think it would look like? Would he try to make it a dictatorship?
Well, I think we already started to see the contours of that in the time that he was there, in terms of kicking out professional diplomats, trying to basically bully members of Congress who had been democratically elected and sort of force them to be loyal to him, basically saying to congressional Republicans, for example, that you won't get elected unless you, you know, basically show fealty to me. Putting in hand-picked loyalists into key positions, you know, we're trying to basically subvert the military. I mean, you know, we've seen that over and over again, him kind of calling my generals, same with the judiciary, my judges, you know, making it very clear when he was presiding over appointments to the Supreme Court that he expected the judges, in the event of some kind of dispute about election outcomes, to favour his position. These are all the hallmarks of the kind of autocracy that we've seen develop in other places. And it's the kind of thing that President Putin has done. In January of 2020, President Putin had an amendment to the Constitution to allow him to run again for multiple terms in office, essentially up to 2036. And Trump has said, and I heard him say it myself, to world leaders in a kind of joking way, again, to normalize it. Huh, wouldn't that be great if I could stay in power forever?
The equivalent of flashing.
Exactly.
And what I like so much about your book is you come at all this from a national security and really a comparative government perspective. It has that high-level look at this, which is why we hear so often or heard so often when he was in power that President Trump was susceptible to flattery, that all you had to do was say nice things. And I think It wasn't that we didn't believe it, but I'm not sure I understood the full depth of that until I read what you had to write about it. How much of a security liability was this susceptibility to flattery?
Well, any kind of susceptibility is a liability, right? I mean, everybody was focused on the idea that maybe the Russians had something they could blackmail him with. But flattery was much more it was just easier to do, right? Much cheaper, much lower cost. You don't have to, you know, be skulking around, you know, getting material. All you had to do was say something nice about him. So there's a classic moment that I talk about in the book where Vladimir Putin went on television. And if you notice, Putin never said anything negative about Trump. And what, on this particular occasion, he was talking about how great the economy was doing. The stock market was rising very rapidly. And he knew that Trump was, very proud of this. So he says something on Russian television. It's related on US television. And the next thing is President Trump wants to have a phone call with Vladimir Putin. And it was just, it was a lure. It was the bait. And at other times, you know, people would appear on usually Fox News who either wanted to get into the administration or wanted to get Trump to do something. And they'd start off talking about praising him, about how amazing a job he was doing. And the next minute, there they would be in the Oval Office having a chat to him. Or, you know, they perhaps might be getting a position in the administration.
So easy. It is just the currency of words there. You know, I wonder, as we have watched in the last few days, this Facebook whistleblower and what we have learned about Facebook's role, confirming some of, obviously, what we already knew. What is a bigger threat to American democracy, Russia, Putin, or Facebook?
Well, I'm afraid Facebook has been, because what did Russia and Putin do? The intelligence services of Russia set up fake personas on Facebook, also, frankly, on Twitter. They had, you know, fake videos all over the place on YouTube. I imagine that they may have also been using many of these other same platforms in the same way. They went on there pretending to be Americans and also exfiltrating content for themselves as well. You know, we focused on Cambridge Analytica, but, you know, we haven't really focused on what the Internet Research Agency in St. Petersburg, Russia, is doing as well. They're getting that same data. They're taking advantage of those same algorithms that Facebook has developed. And, of course, the whistleblower talked about the danger of the algorithms, not just the content. And they've been able to target Americans in the same way. But what they're doing is they're just repackaging the information and the posting that Americans have put on Facebook and others have as well. So they've exploited that platform.
I want to ask you about the title of your book, which is There's Nothing For You Here, although it actually comes from a conversation with your father, and it is what he said to you. He said, there's nothing for you here, pet, which I love. but tell me about that conversation and how it instructs your view of what's happening in the United States right now.
Well, that conversation came just as I was about to leave high school in the north of England in 1984. And there was a 90% youth unemployment crisis at that point. So only 10% of kids leaving school had something to go on to, maybe a place in college or an apprenticeship in a manufacturing company or, you know, something else, training for maybe a teacher or a nurse or something. And basically, you know, my dad was an ex-coal miner. All the coal mines are closed down. By this point, he's working in the local hospital as an orderly. There certainly, you know, it was very difficult for him to find a job. And he just, you know, basically looked at me and said, as a girl in this kind of environment, if you want to make something of your life, there's nothing for you here, pet. You're going to have to go somewhere else. And I got into college, and it was just basically his way of telling me, you know, unfortunately, you're probably not going to come back again. And that's actually how millions of people feel in the UK today and all the way around America as well, where they feel they don't have the opportunity to stay in the place where their families have lived for generations, you know, where their parents worked. They may want to stay, but there's nothing for them here in terms of an educational opportunity or a job. And one of the biggest, I think, factors in all the things we're talking about, the way that people can use disinformation or that someone like President Trump can easily manipulate people, is that education has become a marker for class and opportunity. And in, you know, the days of our parents in the United States, it was incredibly easy to get an education by comparison because there were grants, there were subsidies, the GI Bill for anybody who'd been in the military, for example. And for a kid today, it's actually very difficult to get an education, including getting skills and qualifications that they might need for a job in the new economy.
It is a wonderful book, and your personal story really carries through this book, I think, explaining sort of your connection, understanding some of what the U.S. is going through. Fiona Hill, thank you so much for being with us this
morning. No, thanks. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks a lot. Of course. Next, we have some breaking news.